right, welcome to our recording. Might as well just jump right into it. This is the sun. I took this picture just today. Funny, very interesting that you see it's surrounded by these red dots, right? Almost giving us a clue about the belief that the sun is going to be activated and turn into a red giant. It's going to be activated by this intense galactic superwave carrying this intense magnetism with it. And this magnetism is supposed to begin to activate the sun in late December 2012, you know, 6 months from now. This is the narrative that we have been getting. And the activation of the sun by the highly magnetized galactic superwave, which emanated from the center of the galaxy, is supposed to energize the sun so it burns much much hotter, much more ferociously, and it expends its energy in a burst of activity. This is what's called shifting into a red giant phase. And of course, that is going to cause us troubles here, which is also the narrative that we've been getting. So there's a very much of a consensus among the seers and the contactees and the intuitives and the prophets and all those who, the time travelers, etc., the large contingent here in this world, and I count myself among those, who are aware that something is going to happen with the sun. There's going to be some trouble with the sun. The sun is going to become very unstable. It's going to change in its functioning very quickly, very, very quickly. And all this will be triggered like a thief in the night by the magnetic field of this galactic superwave impinging upon the sun, affecting it. And we won't see it, the magnetic wave, the effects of that, but the sun will begin to somehow expand. I believe the miracle of the sun at Fatima in Portugal, in the early part of last century, depicts that, how the sun is going to seem to get closer and closer and closer and huger, closer to the world, as if it's going to burn up the whole world. Okay, I believe that was a great warning to mankind. And so we are faced with this situation. Now let's go off on a tangent slightly right here. I'll have some fun. Took this picture today. This is my boot Jalokia Naga ghost pepper that I'm growing. And over here you're going to see the habanero pepper that I'm growing. Both of these peppers are extremely hot. This one used to be the hottest pepper in the world. It's been eclipsed by some other tormentors. But there's a real craze these days to eat hot peppers. And I'm just wondering, it's almost like people are simulating what it's like to be burned by fire, isn't it? Yeah, it is that way. These peppers, what they say when they eat them, when they eat like a ghost pepper with a million scars, people are just saying, oh my gosh, I'm on fire. It's like I'm just burning my lips, my mouth, my tongue, my throat, my stomach. It's just like I'm on fire. You know, and they're just suffering and sweating and drooling, and it's just like, oh, I'm burning up, like I've just swallowed lava. This is becoming very popular now, and it's intriguing. I'm intrigued by it. I'm so intrigued by it that I'm actually growing a ghost pepper here, and it's actually growing fabulously well, as is the habanero. And I speculate that this fad of eating these hot peppers is an intuitive awareness that that the world's going to heat up, that we're going to be fried by the intense heat of the sun coming up. And the people are trying to deal with this in certain ways. One of the ways is to simulate being cooked from within, like this intense, fiery heat that lasts a long time, and you're just sitting there just burning up, and nothing helps. You know, they drink water, they drink milk, and it cools for a little bit. I tried a little bit of habanero a couple days ago, and I ate yogurt, and the yogurt stopped it for a little while, but once the effect wore off, boom, it came back, you know, worse than before. It's just awful heat, and that was just a tiny bit. These people are eating incredibly hot peppers. like, oh, just capsaicin, you know, just frying him for a long, long time. And you'll see these videos on YouTube. I've been watching them, and I'm saying, you know what? There's something here. Why are people subjecting themselves to this enormous pain? Okay. Because deep within our intuition, we have a sense that things are going to heat up here right now. A lot of talk over the last decade or so has been about global warming, and everybody's freaked out about global warming, right? Why? Is there really that much of a reason to be freaked out about it and just terrified? Oh, global warming is catastrophe. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. Well, what they're talking about intuitively is the global warming that's coming from the sun expanding into a red giant phase. Okay. Which it will be triggered. This will be caused by this magnetic superwave that is just about ready to sweep through the solar system. And so that is why there's this mania about global warming. I mean, and of course the debate is, well, are humans causing it or not? You know, is this cyclic or not, et cetera, et cetera. Neither side is right. What's happening now is not cyclic, and it's not entirely caused by humans either. It is caused by the outer reaches of this magnetic superwave. These faint echoes of it are starting to reach the sun. Starting to heat up the solar system. The solar system's already heating up. Look at the other planets in the solar system. It's a solar system-wide phenomenon, okay? Because when people talk about, you know, we humans are causing this global warming, well, what's causing the warming on the other planets of the solar system? Right? What's causing it is the forward ripples of this galactic superwave of magnetism and high energy particles. That's what's causing it. So when the sun gets hit by the full brunt of this superwave, here's the sun as okay, and then when it gets hit by this galactic superwave, it's gonna go like that. Okay, I took both these pictures today. Starts out like this, and then it expands into this. And so you have all these people downing these milkweed units, ghost peppers and Moruga scorpions and all this strains of incredibly hot peppers. And they're saying, okay, I can survive that. I can survive that. You know, they're feeling like, yeah, this is helping me. It's kind of like magic, isn't it? Thinking that this is going to help them. Well, the question is, what is really going to help us? Should this narrative come to pass? And there is an overall consensus that a wave is coming. Okay, we've known about this for a long time. And where we differ is exactly what is going to happen when this wave reaches us. Probably a whole lot of different stuff is going to happen. I say that the sun is going to be influenced and is going to give off extraordinary heat. Now, exactly, is the earth going to be protected from that? As some are saying that they're building a Merkaba around the planet, that all building this flower of life Merkaba around the planet to protect the magnetosphere of the planet. Others say that there's going to be an evacuation of this planet. Either the entire population of the planet will be evacuated, or those who are tuned into divine love will be evacuated. There are some that say the planet is going to metamorphosize into two planets, a third dimensional and a fourth dimensional planet. And those who shift into the fourth dimension will not be affected by the magnetic superwave and the red giant expansion of the sun. Whereas those who stay in third dimensional Earth are going to be cooked. Okay, there's that belief. There's a belief that we'll all be fried. Okay, there's that. There's the belief that evacuations will be both to very benign, beautiful places and also to slave planets where the lower order third dimensional beings will essentially come here and take people to be slaves in other planets. There's that belief. Some will say that the orbs, angelic orbs, will come and shift people into the true light of our true consciousness and true being, and that will protect us, and we will shift into higher domain. There's a whole vast slew, and then there's also the belief that this galactic superwave, as it sweeps through the solar system, is going to shift the DNA, and the very substance of matter is going to mutate matter at the deepest levels, subatomic levels, and this is going to cause us to shift into higher consciousness. Man, so there you go, pick 'em. You know, maybe all of the above. Okay, maybe all of the above. I can see possibilities for all of that. I would say the best bet is to focus on unconditional love and realize that you're already qualified for that, to respond to that, to rest in the arms of unconditional love. We're all pre-qualified because we were created as perfect and immaculate and invulnerable. And what we did was we tried to change what we are. So we're engaged in this vast effort to change what we are. And that is what we see as the external world. All this stuff going on in the world, in existence, in the cosmos, the solar system, the universe, on this planet, everything is really a dance of energy for the purpose of trying to create a separate reality. And we want to be prime creators of that separate reality. We want to be the ones creating the prime creators. And all of this is like a dream of forgetfulness of what we really are. And so it doesn't really matter what happens in this dream of forgetfulness of what we are. What matters is that we choose a dream of remembrance of what we are. And this unconditional love is like a dream of remembrance of what we are. And if we return to that, then nothing in the dream of forgetfulness will affect us one way or the other. It will not cause any disturbance in unconditional love and our response to it. And so that is the highest teaching there is. If you look at all the teachings throughout history, the highest teaching is the fact that we are all have equal access to this unconditional love. The unconditional love is here right now, is present. It's perfect stillness right now, right here, all times, all places, all situations. It's the perfect overlay of existence, and we have perfect access to it right now. Everyone has 100% access to it right now, with no need to qualify, no requirements whatsoever. It's non-judgmental. This pure unconditional love passes no judgment. It is equally present for all. So we're all 100% pre-qualified, 100% access, and we can never be disqualified in any way. No matter how we act out our dreams of forgetfulness, that does not disqualify us from the dream of remembrance of what we are. Okay, because what we are can do no harm, because reality cannot be harmed. So who has sinned against reality is the question. And the answer is no one has sinned against reality. Okay. And all other so-called sin is merely the dance of forgetfulness. Different ways and means that we utilize to try and maintain a state of forgetfulness of what we are. And that's not a sin against reality. That's simply a delay. It's a delaying tactic. And the way to get over that delaying tactic is to respond to unconditional love, which will perfectly remind us of what we really are. Okay, and then we'll see that we never sinned. We never harmed anything. We didn't harm ourselves. We didn't harm any other aspect of spirit, and that we're all simply part of this oneness. We are the oneness. There is no two-ness. There's just this oneness. Reality is all one. We have to be reminded of that. We need a dream of remembrance, and that's what unconditional love is. This is the highest teaching. I really believe this. No one is greater or lesser. We're already pre-qualified, which means we don't need to do anything to qualify for this, to respond to unconditional love. It's there for us already, there for everyone, equally. So nobody, no matter what happens to the forms, any forms, that doesn't change the fact that unconditional love is present for us every moment. And we can turn to it at any moment. We don't have to be eating those ghost peppers and suffering through the pain of it and hoping, you know, maybe this will toughen me up for what is to come. The best thing to do is to rest in the arms of unconditional love. And some will do that. Some will do it. We hope that all of us here sharing this video here will do it. And in order to do it, we need to work through some issues that we have. There's some heavy issues we have that kind of make us reluctant to do this. But if we look at them, they kind of vanish. I've been looking at them quite a bit recently, and right now I'm looking, I don't really see any good reason not to. You know, once you bring something to light, it no longer seems to be such an obstacle. It was an obstacle because it was in the dark and you couldn't see it. Once you see it, then you can say, oh, I can step over that. Okay. It loses its boogeyman status as something to be terrified and stop on the path and say, I know I can't go any further. There's something there. I don't know what it is. Shine the light on it and you say, ah, it's just a little stone there, you know, no problem. I can go forward now. So what we're doing is we are facing the future in a realistic way. We're not burying our heads in the sand and saying nothing's going to happen. We're moving forward. Taking step by step by step by step, it may seem like we're upside down, okay? And it may seem awkward. But that's just from the perception of the world, that we're upside down. Really, what we're doing is we're turning things right side up. And getting the right perspective. Yes, there is trouble coming with the sun, okay? If we can shift to the sun. Yes, there's trouble coming with the sun. But no, we don't have to go into a panic. We can take even though we feel, you know, wow, something's upside down. Something's upside down. But we're not upside down. We are getting right side up right now. So let us focus in on unconditional love. And if we want to eat a ghost pepper, we can. I don't know if I will or not. Hopefully not. Because I cannot take that type of heat. It's interesting. I guess the people who eat those things, they feel an endorphin rush. You know, kind of for a while they feel like no pain at all, because the endorphins have kicked in so badly. But when the sun heats up, I tell you, endorphin to save at that point in time. If we now the elites, the story goes, the narrative goes, and there's a lot of collaboration for this, that the elites have been warned about this in advance, and I'm sure they have been, because this planet has been in contact with extraterrestrials for quite some time. And the crop circles that you see, the sophisticated ones that point out the planetary alignments and the cosmic the astrophysics of the cosmos and what's going to happen, those are very sophisticated crop circles that are created by very much high intelligence as far as certain matters go. Those intelligences contacted the world in the past, probably starting with Eisenhower there, out in what is now at Edwards Air Force Base, when he was on vacation in Palm Springs. other countries have been contacted. There's been a lot of contact take place, and there's been a lot of warnings taking place, and the Vatican knows about it, or the governments know about it. That's why they've constructed all these seed banks to protect them from the heat of the sun, what's going to happen. And they have also constructed underground complexes, which are energy sufficient, hydroponic greenhouse growing, and able to ride out any, you know, severe disturbance on the surface of the planet. And so the elites have already built these underground complexes. So when the sun starts to turn into a giant, they're going to disappear under the surface of the earth. But those who don't have that option, you know, what are their options? Is sort of what we're asking. And some say simply that this galactic superwave will just be very benign, and everything will just be transmutated into a higher state of consciousness. We wish, right? We wish for that. Not sure how that's going to play out, right? But we would certainly welcome clarification on this. Wishful thinking is not necessarily truth. It's not necessarily wrong either. I did have a dream one time where I was on this earth, and in a flash, a twinkling of an eye, something changed instantly. And I looked about and I said, huh, what's different? Everything seems a little bit different. What happened? And I began to touch the soil and examine it, and the soil was different. And I began to walk around the world, and I saw that plants grew incredibly well, instantaneously. You could put a plant in there in the morning, and if you wanted it to, it would grow and be bearing you fruit by dinner time. And it was what happened was the entire soil of the planet turned intelligent. And I experienced this. I literally experienced this. There was this new world with soil that was intelligent. The whole planet was intelligent, was alive, was loving, would provide whatever you wanted. You could stick a seed into the ground or a shoot, and just your intention, whatever your intention was, that the soil would provide this for you. It was amazing. Happened in a blink of an eye. So I am not discounting that a transmutation of this planet can happen, because I, at some level, I experienced it already. But I'm not willing to say that that's the only option there is. We have these various options on our plate right now. And as we go forward in the next 6 months, I believe we need to continue to focus in on what our options are. We don't need to belabor the fact that this big major is going to happen. We're going to run into some kind of wall, as it were. Wall of energy, a wall of high energy. It may feel like we're running into some kind of wall. Some say it's going to fragment everything here in 3D, just absolutely shred it all, melt it down, etc., etc., etc. But we can remain calm, as we're doing here, have a little bit of humor, and take a look at the situation and see how we can best respond to this situation. What are our best options? And I come back to, again, unconditional love as being the best focus at the time. Now, some are doing group meditations on the Merkaba, the flower of life, and trying to work with their energy and projecting it and trying to protect the planet, etc. I don't see anything wrong with that, doing that. What I would like to see is meditation with those who radiate perfect assurance that we're pre-qualified to respond to unconditional love. And where those meditations are, we need to find those. I would say that for, at least for me, I would say that would be the highest response to what is coming, is to be reassured, to be in the presence, perfect reassurance, that we are entitled to respond to unconditional love, that we need not meet any requirements other than to simply do it. There's nothing more than simply to allow it. It's an allowance. Let it happen. It's there. It even provides the means to respond to it. We need to simply surrender all efforts to not allow it to happen, which are arrogant, ego-based efforts to try and change what we are, right? Because unconditional love will remind us what we are. And if we don't allow this to be experienced, we are basically saying, no, we want to come up with our own remedy. We want to stay in charge. We want to continue on with our effort to create a new reality, a separate reality. We want to be continue to try and be prime creators, to pretend to be prime creators. So we're not allowing it yet. We're not allowing it. I have been praying for 15 years for someone to come into the world who has this quality of reassurance for us. Extremely important. And so far it hasn't happened. Very surprising. Very surprising. Because we definitely need it. Even if there was nothing coming in the future, we still have a world that is tremendously combative. We're entering into a time of combativeness in the world. You can feel it, right? Hell Week is just basically passing now. The last 7 days have been a time. I call it Hell Week because there was a fundamental shift in the world towards combativeness. With the Supreme Court rulings, and around this reverberates around the world. America, USA is a very important country, of course, and the mood of the USA is a mood that is felt in many places in the world. Our policy, our foreign policy, and all of that, you know, is very significant. European Union too, India, China, Japan, you know, a lot of countries have a lot of influence, but the U.S. has a tremendous influence, and the election that is coming up soon is tremendously contested and very combative. It's going to become very combative. The mood in the world, Syria and Turkey, Iran, Israel, there are Afghanistan, NATO, etc., etc. There's a feeling of combativeness now. It's almost like we have left the mode of constructive dialogue, of love-based dialogue, of dialogue that says, you know, when I grew up, there was this teaching. Some of you will remember this. It's called, I'm okay, you're okay. That was the, you see, when I grew up, psychologists were king and queen. They were the authorities, psychoanalysts, psychologists. So whenever a book came out, you know, of important new psychological therapy, you know, everyone was like so into it. You know, it was amazing. This book came out, I'm okay, you're okay. And we really tried to relate to one another from the standpoint of therapy. We all felt we were in therapy. I was in therapy. Everyone was in therapy. We're trying to find out who we are, right? And what we were told, you know, just say, I'm okay, you're okay. Which was kind of a way of saying, I'm pre-qualified, you're pre-qualified. And if, just imagine if we could get back to that. I mean, there was a time there in the 60s and the 70s where we really had some hope. I have to tell you this. Those who lived through that can confirm this, that we really believed that the world was going to be saved and go in the right direction towards peace and non-confrontation, non-combativeness. And we felt we had the tools to do it. And one of these was, I'm okay, you're okay. An update of that is what I'm sharing with you now, is that I'm pre-qualified, you're pre-qualified, they're pre-qualified, we're all pre-qualified. So let's lay down our weapons, lay down our combativeness. Let's just sit quietly and just allow this realization to permeate us. That's all we need to do. And we really need some Krishnamurti, great teacher Krishnamurti. He came to the West and would just sit quietly and give quiet talks. And people would just allow the realization to set in what he was saying. Truth is a pathless land. There's no hierarchy in truth. And the same thing he was saying, I'm okay, you're okay. I'm pre-qualified, you're pre-qualified. Those are the great teachers who radiate this absolute assurance because they are living it. They know it. They can see it perfectly clearly. All right, it's not a concept or faith to them. It's a knowing. It's a being. They're being it. They've realized their true self, their true identity. They're one with it. And they know. They know we are all pre-qualified. They know it beyond any dispute. Okay. And so no matter what happens in the world, they radiate that assurance. They're not making some mental effort to project this. It is simply the radiance of their being, of knowingness. It's the radiance of knowingness, of beingness. I'm okay, you're okay. I'm pre-qualified, you're pre-qualified. Everyone's pre-qualified. It's been that way from the very beginning. We'll be that way always. We're pre-qualified to remember what we are. This is the highest teaching. This is what we need in the world. We don't need concepts. A clarification is helpful. That's mid-level teaching, which is what I'm doing. But what we really need is the assurance that is radiated, radiation of assurance. And to simply sit quietly and feel this assurance and let it sink in and get more and more closer to allowing ourselves to feel, to experience, to respond to unconditional love. This path, you can't lose with this path. It's the highest path, and yet it really is boosted by the presence of a perfect assurance, by perfect assurance. I think we need that big boost, and I that's been my aim for the last 15 years exclusively. We need a big boost at this time. And I'm still praying, and my intention is that we will get that opportunity. And I've been looking for such a teacher anywhere. And I've come across many, many, many teachers in this world now. There are many. And I've yet to come across a single one that radiates this 100% assurance. Okay. There are, some are better than others, of course. They you know, but the one who can simply sit there and you just know that, oh my gosh, I am pre-qualified and everyone else here is pre-qualified. Oh my gosh. And just let that sink in, and there's, you know, there's no need for any dialogue. Our talk, any talk that can be there, superficial, etc. The great reassurers. There are some now on this planet who do reassure. To a certain extent, they are functioning as a reassurer of this. But it can get better. Okay, that is, I guess that's what I'm saying. It can get better. Because I come from the lineage of the 20th century of teachers like Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Mayama, who were great reassurers. You can call them perfect reassurers. And so I know that that is possible. That is possible. It is literally possible to have someone here where you know beyond any doubt that you're pre-qualified. And it's this shocking, stunning, you know, it's a wonderful, wow, oh my gosh, and you just want to sit there and you just want to let it sink in. It's greater than a cosmic galactic superwave. You realize this is way beyond that. I am pre-qualified to respond to unconditional love, an unconditional love which is untouched by any galactic superwave. Galactic superwave doesn't even cause the slightest ripple in unconditional love. And I am pre-qualified right now to respond to that fully. This is the great gift that the great teachers give us. And with that boost, we would accept it and we would allow it. I'm convinced of that. In the meantime, we have to do our very best and try to allow it in our lives. And some may do that. There are some teachers who are giving reassurance, and some go to them and they seem to get a certain measure of reassurance. Okay? Again, in the next 6 months, I would like to do better than that. I would like to, no disrespect to any teacher. There are some very fine teachers in the world right now doing their utmost to help. I just know that it is possible to get an even more profound reassurance. Okay? It is possible. Because in the past on this planet, there have been those teachers who were like, you know, super teachers. They had just a super reassurance. That just to be even near them, you just get this incredible feeling of reassurance that yes, you know, unconditional love is there. I'm qualified to respond to it. And I, right now, yes, I can. That is the real yes, I can, or yes, we can. Yes, we can respond to unconditional love. And in doing so, we will know that whatever happens in this world, we'll be fine. We'll be better than fine. We'll be absolutely blissful. We don't need any mutation. We don't need any transmutation. Unconditional love responding to that, that is remembrance, perfect remembrance of what we are, our true identity. And our true identity is eternal. It is perfect. It is flawless. It is invulnerable. It is all-knowing. Its functionality is perfect, and it has an infinite richness of experiencing for it at all times. That is what we truly are, and we have the means to remember this. No matter what happens with the cosmos, we have the means to remember this right now. We don't need no galactic superwave to respond to unconditional love. We don't need anything to happen, or we don't need anything not to happen either. Either way, we're all pre-qualified. There's no such thing as saying, I'm not good enough for this. Oh, yes, we are. We're pre-qualified because we didn't create ourselves. Okay, we are not a work in progress. Our identity is not a work in progress. We were created complete, whole, perfect from the very beginning. Okay, we were created to complete the prime creator's creation. We are the effect of the prime creator's idea. The prime creator creates and we confirm the creation, because a creation without any effects is an unconfirmed creation. It's incomplete, isn't it? So of course a cause has to have its effects in order to be a cause, right? But we did not create ourselves. So the notion of saying that I'm imperfect, that's arrogance. Okay, there's two types of arrogance, it's all the same. One is to say, I'm so great, I can be in charge of my own salvation. I don't need unconditional love. I can work it out with my own mind, and I will be in charge of my salvation. And I am God, you know, all these things, saying things like that. That's arrogance. And also it's arrogance to say that, oh, I'm not qualified, I'm not good enough, I'm a sinner, it's not justifiable, I don't have the sufficient resume of goodness to experience unconditional love. That's only for the really good people, etc. That's arrogance too, because it's putting your own qualifications on unconditional love. Okay, and it's denying what your true identity really is. Your true identity is perfectly qualified to remember what it is. Pre-qualified. Everyone's pre-qualified. And there is nothing at all that this about to change this in any way. I don't care whether the sun remains the same or it becomes a red giant. It doesn't matter, because we are absolutely entitled. We're both qualified and entitled to remember what we are. Pre-qualified, all of us. We're entitled to it. The sun cannot take away this entitlement. Nothing can take it away. If we're entitled, we're entitled, period. If we're pre-qualified, we're pre-qualified. There's no way to disqualify us, because we didn't qualify ourselves. We were qualified by the prime creator. God, the prime creator, says, this is my son, this is my creation. So certainly we're qualified to be what we are, right? How could we be disqualified to be what we are? The fact that we had a dream of separation, a dream of forgetfulness, does that disqualify us from being what we are? No, how can a dream disqualify us from being what we are? It only casts a shroud of forgetfulness over what we are. We're not sure, we can remember, but we feel confused, uncertain about it. That doesn't disqualify us from being what we are. We cannot disqualify ourselves. God created us as spirit and truth, eternal being, and that is what we are. We don't have the power or authority to change what we are. We do not have it. So how can we be disqualified from remembering what we are? It's impossible. No red giant galactic superwave can disqualify us. It can't qualify us either. We're pre-qualified. Okay, I know there are some that are waiting to be qualified, saying this will qualify us. This energy is God's way of qualifying us. No, we're already pre-qualified. We've always been, from the moment we decided to try and change what we are. Unconditional love was present for us to help us, to enable us to remember what we are and remind us that we're pre-qualified. Prior to that, we didn't need to remember what we were, right? It's only when we choose to forget what we are that the effect of remembrance is put in place, right? That must be that way. When we were functioning flawlessly in reality, as we still are, and we decided, you know what, we want to be prime creator, so we want to create a new reality, so we want to forget what we are, forget about what we are. No, we want to be prime creator. The moment that dream arose, that desire arose, right, again, the means to remember what we are arose simultaneously with it. So it's always been there from the very beginning, simultaneously. It's present right now, has always been present, always will be present in existence. And then after existence, the last aspect of spirit drops the dream of trying to change what they are. Unconditional love, that blessing will remain upon all of reality as a silent, still presence, always there. These are the teachings that enable us to deal with what is to come here, that calm us down, keep us from panicking, also keeping us from getting too elated by any external circumstances, knowing that the kingdom of heaven is within. Unconditional love is within us. It's already present. It's more than within us. It's omnipresent. It's an overlay of all time, places, circumstances, and existence. It's everywhere. We can never be apart from it. We can never go anywhere where we're apart from it, or separate from it, distanced from it. We can't distance ourselves from it at all. And this awareness helps us relax and be relieved, because realizing no matter what any aspect of spirit does, however they act out, they're not distancing themselves from unconditional love at all. Doesn't matter where they go or where they don't go. Nothing matters as far as that's concerned. It's only the realization of this that we're all aimed towards. So if we can get the big boost, if we can get a situation where we simply are reassured about unconditional love to the extent where we feel it like going through us, deeper than any concept, belief, or faith, a knowingness that through and through permeates us. We have that, and we simply abide in that knowingness that's permeating us, and abide quietly with that. That spreads the assurance throughout the world. So it's possible for this assurance to be spread throughout the world. It's still possible. We have 6 months to get it done. I'm still holding out hope. If it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. And we have to do the best we can with allowing ourselves to respond to unconditional love. We can do that. We can do it. So it's a win-win. We continue to do our utmost to do this. Continue to invoke the intention that a perfect reassurer shows up here. A genuine reassurer. We will know it. We will know it. Because it will not be an attraction of affection. There certainly is possible false teachers can show up, and their reassurance will be based on what's called affection. Sentiment, affection, attractiveness, passion, all those kinds of things, romance, romanticism, etc. That's what the flavor will be. We'll be able to tell the difference. A real teacher has this 100% pure, immaculate, unconditional love, reassurance. It has nothing to do with affection, with physical attraction, with emotion, with sentiment, with romanticism, with any of this. you feel this just totally pure, immaculate, unchanging, unwavering, effortless assurance of unconditional love. That is a genuine teacher. The counterfeit kind attract through various forms of attractiveness other than that. And they can throw out all sorts of attractive stuff, you know, that attracts faith and belief. But it's not this knowingness that permeates us. You know, there's something there which isn't quite right. We realize that. So we have to hold out for the genuine article. We have to hold out for that. We have to insist on the genuine article. Not anything counterfeit. Not anything substandard. Not anything that is has a base of affection. A lot of, sometimes the heart-centered stuff has undercurrents, various undercurrents to it. This is beyond the head. It is beyond the heart. It is a complete, permeates completely, totally, as if there's no beginning and no end to this permutation. There's no beginning, there's no ending. The saturation, there's complete saturation. There's no locus to it. It's not here, it's not centered here, it's not centered there, it's not centered anywhere. It just is. There's no center to this isness. We're not seeking for a center to it. We're not seeking for our salvation. We're not seeking for us to be enlightened. We're seeking to experience the enlightenment of all, the enlightenment of the entire cosmos. That is what we are seeking to experience. That is what unconditional love is. We're all equally enlightened. We're seeking to experience that which overlays everything. We're not seeking to enlighten our minds for us to become an enlightened master, enlightened guru, our self-realization. There is no I, all of this kind of stuff. We're seeking this experiencing of total suffusion of all of existence in this unconditional love, perfectly still, perfectly calm, already present right now, here and now. And just be aware of that. I'm resting in the arms of unconditional love. You are, they are, every plant, every tree. This is why they say God is in everything I see. In other words, everything I see is overlaid and resting in the arms of this unconditional love. That is the experience we're looking for. It is not that I am saved and you have yet to be saved. No, you see that everyone, the love is present there for everyone. Now, others can deny this fact, but you can see this as a fact. This is what the great teachers tell us. They can see it as a fact. Everything is already suffused, completely permeated and suffused, and resting in the arms of unconditional love right now. It's already a fact. And they see this and they say, wow, the universe is already saved. It's always been saved. It's only a denial that has been saved that keeps us in this ridiculous dance. But everything is already saved. Not just me or you, everything simultaneously. It's not that I entered first and you were second. No, everything, you see, everything simultaneously has always been this way. From the very beginning, everything has already been saved. Perfect remembrance has already been there, right there with everything. Always be that way. That is the experience that the great teachers radiate out this assurance to us. And this is what we're asking for. This is our intention. This is what we want to experience. We want to experience the simultaneous salvation of everything. We want to realize that everything is equal access. Unconditional love is there in the exact same quantity, quality, same stillness, same seamlessness everywhere, to all. Nothing is special. No such thing as specialness. Okay, we want to free ourselves from the delusion of something has special access to this. Something is more special than something else. Something is better than something else. Something is special. That's the ego. We want to free ourselves from that. And some people have in the past have called it equal vision. Equal vision. Vision of true equality. Everything is already equal. We don't need to be fighting for equality because everyone already has equal access to unconditional love. It's already there for everyone, everything, equally. All we need to do is accept this fact and allow ourselves to experience it. That is the entirety of the spiritual path. That's all there is to it. And some simply do it easily. They just do it because they're ready for it. Others, you know, we struggle with it. I've struggled with it. But the struggle has been towards clarification, and that's very helpful. Clarification is very, very helpful. Ramana Maharshi says, until you experience it, you have to struggle with it and clarify with it. You have to really battle your way because obstacles will seem to arise, which is true, which is very true. And those who seem to easily accept it, well, they've done their battles previously for sure. Unless there's a incarnation of one who has never fallen into trying to change what they are. And then that one is effortlessly reassures everyone from the very beginning of their lives. That's very possible too. There's no reason why not all aspects of spirit chose to try and be prime creator. Not all aspects. Many did. Many aspects of spirit did do this. But I don't know how many aspects did not, but I'm assuming many did not. And those aspects they don't even need remembrance. They already know. They have always known what they are. And they can show up in this world, animate a body, and give us this reassurance. Not a problem for them. They never chose to try and be prime creator. They never chose to try and forget what they are. So they don't need any process of remembering either. There's pure knowingness here all the time. So certainly this can take place in the world. And Anandamayi Maha was an example of that. There have probably been other examples of that throughout history. No process of remembrance necessary there. But we are engaged in this because we got pulled into trying to forget what we are. We kind of said, gee, what's going on? This is kind of interesting. I wonder what this is about. And we jumped in, and we're now kind of regretting that, saying, wow, enough is enough. You know, enough is enough. That's enough of this forgetting. It's the bloom is off that rose. Because it's suffering. Buddha said it best. Existence is suffering. Very true. And some of us are realizing that existence is suffering. That's what it is. Trying to forget what we are is suffering. That's all that it is. We can sugarcoat it as much as we can. We can eat that yogurt to take off the burn of the ghost pepper. But the yogurt wears off and boom, the burn is right back. Oh man, you know, when they eat the ghost pepper, they're going to suffer. There's no way to stop that suffering. Many have tried different ways, drinking milk, but the burn is still there. It's there. Just like that, when we try to be prime creator, we have to forget what we are, we jump into forgetfulness of what we are, this whole crazy dance of forgetfulness we call existence, the play of energy, we suffer. We really suffer. For a while, we're wondering, what is this? What is this feeling? What is this suffering? It's interesting. I wonder where it goes, where it can lead me, how it can motivate me, all this stuff. And eventually we realize, it doesn't lead us anywhere. It just leads us into more suffering. Then we get into saying, well, I got to qualify myself to be greater than what I am so I don't suffer anymore. That just leads us into even worse suffering. because again, that just deepens our forgetfulness of what we are, because we're assuming that there's some kind of levels to what we are, that what we are is a work in progress, that we can somehow earn salvation from suffering. No, we're all pre-qualified from the very beginning to not suffer, to be what we are, to know what we are. We're all pre-qualified to remember what we are and to be freed of suffering, all of us. It's never a time in our sojourns throughout this crazy hypothetical scenario of forgetting what we are. There's never a moment where we weren't pre-qualified, perfectly pre-qualified to remember what we are and get free of it. Never a moment. And there never will be a moment, as a fact. So no one is forsaken. There are many who pretend to be forsaken, and therefore that justifies their actions. You know, they may act in crazy ways because they say, well, reality has forsaken me, and now I must establish a new kingdom of my own because I've been forsaken. Nonsense. You don't have to agree with that type of insanity. There are many demagogues like that, you know, who justify their desire to control everyone else and enslave everyone else under the rubric of that they have been disqualified from remembering what they are, been disqualified from being a member of the kingdom of heaven. They make these crazy, arrogant claims, and then they use that to justify their actions. You don't have to agree with that, their arrogance. You can just say, no, you're pre-qualified just the same as I'm pre-qualified. We're all equally pre-qualified. Okay? And you don't have to go on with their efforts, arrogant efforts, to build some kind of vast resume of greatness for themselves. Now, why waste time on trying to be great in existence? Jesus said, blessed are the meek in spirit, for they shall inherit the kingdom. Meaning, those who realize are already pre-qualified, they don't have to, they don't go out trying to aggrandize themselves in the world. They don't go out trying to tell everyone that they can help them become greater, help them qualify, as it were, for unconditional love. No, the meek simply tell everyone, you're already pre-qualified. Everyone's pre-qualified, and we can experience the fact that everyone's pre-qualified. In other words, their enlightenment is the enlightenment of all, that everyone is enlightened. That's real enlightenment. Everyone is already enlightened, has always been so. They're just in temporary denial of this fact. Why? Because they're playing this silly game of wanting to be prime creator, trying to create a separate reality. That's how I see it. And that's how other teachers have seen it. And it fits. The shoe fits, doesn't it? It really fits. I've had this clarity for 15 years. It's becoming more and more clear. And I've never had a moment where I felt that this something didn't fit, that this is wrong. No, nothing like that. I don't have God being angry with me, or the Holy Spirit saying, oh, you're wrong, or teachers saying you're crazy, or nothing like that, nothing. Just the opposite. I've had encouragement saying, yeah, you're right on track. Just stick with it. So I really believe that this is so. We're all pre-qualified. We haven't damaged what we are. We don't need to heal our identity. We don't need to fix what we are. It's never been damaged. We made a facsimile, a symbol of it, and then have been tearing the symbol apart and saying, oh, look at all the damage to our identity. But damage to a symbol is not damage to reality. We can tear a symbol apart. We can't tear reality apart. We can fragment a symbol. We can't fragment reality. It's impossible. So we don't need to heal anything. We don't need to fix anything. Really, we need to give up the attempt, the arrogant attempt, to claim that what we are needs healing, that what we are needs fixing, because that's right back into the old changing what we are. Even though the change seems to be a positive change, it's still the belief we can change what we are. Therefore, it's still entirely delusional. You can hear that very well. Even our desire to make ourselves better, to heal ourselves, to fix ourselves, to improve ourselves, that's exactly the same thing as trying to make ourselves less or different in some way. It's saying we can change what we are. We just kind of trying to sneak this through by saying, but it's a positive change. Yeah. Of course, we can change our personalities, our persona, all this symbolic identity. We can make endless changes in that. Some we say are better, some are worse, etc., etc. That has nothing to do with what we are. We're not changing what we really are. We're changing a fantasy, symbolic fantasy of what we are, an image of what we are. But what we are doesn't need healing. And we, by responding to unconditional love, we feel that. We realize it. Because we say, ah, this unconditional love, it doesn't need healing. It doesn't need fixing at all. And after a while, we start to say, hey, you know what? This reminds me of something. And then we start saying, oh my gosh, it reminds me of who I really am. I don't need change, fixing, or healing either. Okay, but we deserve this intermediate step because we're so used to being in delusion that we're afraid that if we experience ourselves directly, something will go wrong. So we have this intermediate step. Experience unconditional love, which doesn't need healing or fixing in any way. Doesn't need changing. Say, gee, wouldn't change a thing. And I'm happy to experience like this unconditional love forever. It's so wonderful. The outcome of that is we say, ah, I am that. I am the same as that. I am unchanging. I cannot be changed. I cannot be modified, and I'm perfectly happy with that, you see? So really, responding to unconditional love is this great intermediate step. It's a step of remembering. It's a step of awakening. That is what we need to do. It's very simple what we need to do. The more we hear this, the more we listen to this, the more we focus on it, the easier it becomes. To focus even more clearly, without the tension, without the fear, without the confusion, without feeling strange or bothered by it, you know? It becomes easier and easier and easier to say, oh yeah, okay. And then we would hope, we would eventually get the opportunity to sit with a perfect reassurer. Sitting means just being in the presence. Whether the presence is a virtual presence or a physical presence, or in the presence of a reassurer where they don't really need to say anything because they know that you know what you're there for. You're just there to be reassured that taking this step is perfectly fine. No trouble. No pressure. You can take it or not, but just simply you're there because you want to be reassured in the right way. I guess you could even talk about the weather, but you know, you both know this is what I'm here for. We're here for this purpose. This video, we're here for the purpose of clarification. Okay. Where we're looking at this situation saying, aha, I see what's going on. I got a better picture of it now. Okay, very good. Very good. But ultimately, we're leading up to reassurance. The profound reassurance. And there are some that may even just skip that and not even need to come across a perfect reassurer and just simply say, yeah, I get it, and I'll take that step right now. That's very possible. Nothing stands in the way of that. Nothing stands in the way. And we may end up doing that. Who knows? But we better do it in the next 6 months. Okay? Now, I don't know for sure when the troubles of the sun will begin, but there is certainly so much indication that it could be sometime at the end of 2012 and then in the beginning part of 2013. It's very possible. I wouldn't bet against that at all. We've been getting warnings about this for a long, long time. And the signs are certainly there that indicate that, yeah, we're very close. I would say 100% sure we're very close to this, and whether it comes, you know, in the end of 2012, beginning of 2013, 2015, who, you know, whatever, we're close. We're close enough that we need to put a full court press on. We need to give everything we got, which is what I'm, you know, trying to do. And so far, I've been able to keep up with things, been able to work around all the technical difficulties, which have been many, 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 and able to present these videos for those few who are tuned into this at this point. And at some point, maybe I'll invite some others. You know, you're free to invite others to watch these videos. I haven't done any inviting really yet, as far as, you know, contacting people on YouTube and say, why don't you come on out, watch the channel. I haven't done any of that. I just let it happen the way, you know, without it. But I don't know if I'll do that or not. But I certainly believe it's important that whoever you're listening to is stressing this reassurance, this effortless reassurance, that we have, everyone has equal access to unconditional love right now, and at all moments, where in all situations, that guy who's eating that Naga ghost pepper, you know, he has that perfect access to unconditional love right now too. Doesn't have to, you know, whether he's burning inside or not, same thing. Whatever anyone is doing, they're not disqualifying themselves. So there's a certain shift that happens in feeling this, and we're getting very close to it here, touching upon it. There's some kind of realization that all is well, and at a certain point we know it, and we are getting close to that point, knowing all is well. So very great. We've done this, and it's what it's about, a little over an hour here. And I will keep trying to post these videos, and what maybe some of it will click for you. And you'll say, okay, yeah, some epiphany, something will click, and you have a mini realization. That's good. Mini realizations are good, very good, because it helps align your faith and your belief. And at some point we go beyond the mini realizations to the fullness of realization, yet that all is well. All has always been well. Can never be otherwise. Unconditional love cannot distance itself from anything or anyone. It's impossible. There's never been any distancing. Never will be. You get all these people, they're in a movie and they're watching all these horrible, you know, combativeness there, you know, and you think, oh, those poor lost souls. No, they're not lost. All is well with them too. The gurus, the real gurus, the top ones, they just smile. They just smile. They're so happy because they know all is well. So with that mini realization here, we will bring an end to this video, and I'll work on posting it for you. Very great. That's it.